over to the commentary desk.
Great work, guys. Man, I am super excited to cast these two players, but not just that. Pig, I'm casting with you.
Oh my God.
This is crazy.
This is the first time we've actually ever cast together, isn't it?
I think so, right?
Yeah.
I've been to many events with you, but I think we've now basically had every possible combo.
Yeah, I mean, I'm basically that jealous girl as well, who kind of, you know, I've been trying to separate you and Dan for a while.
Yeah,
I've been trying to work it in.
You've been good at being kind of flirty with me, and then I was like,
secretly sending texts on like each other's phones and stuff. And
all right, guys, tell your friends to join us. This is going to be a very special match. Down in the bottom left, in the red, he is Jokchi.
Looking intense right there. Of course, his opponent down here in the bottom right-hand side, the Blue Zerg. It is Impact.
This should be a really close series. I am hoping we get to go to game number 3. I was really wondering how much B-Corp Strong paid you to get your photo down there in the bottom, Pig. You're looking great. That's Pig going, roaches!
Can I say? I've got to get the endorsements going, you know?
That's right.
Got to make the most.
Got to make the most of what you can, Pig. How did you get your ID anyways?
I just love pigs, man. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I started out, my ID originally was Fat Pig Soccer, and that was too embarrassing. So I shortened it to Pig. Apparently, nine-year-old pig kind of came up with some terrible nicknames.
Yeah.
I kind of fixed it up. They have curly tails, bacon.
They do.
Do you like bacon, Nick?
I love bacon.
Yeah.
And I love pot-belly pigs. Ones are so cute.
Yeah.
And, you know, pigs are smarter than dogs, which is why you're such a good caster.
Thanks, Nick. That's
no
the,
problem.
The height of compliments coming
no
in
problem,
here at the Intelligent Game Masters.
Oh, man. All right. So, on this map, we're going to see just how aggressive Jokchi is going to be. We've seen already in some of our earlier games, Jokchi really getting into his opponent's face. And a lot of times, those games tend to snowball out of control. Impact is, I'd say, a player with a pretty wide range, but I would say he is definitely somebody who can do aggression early on. And he's very comfortable doing some kind of timing.
I remember a few months back, I can't remember if it was Gyeonggi or sometime around then, maybe before then, there was like an entire few tournaments where all Impact did was just like all in. Like he'd never go past 20 workers and he'd just kind of rush across the map with like a fast Ling Bane or a fast Roach Ling. So he definitely has that in his arsenal. But so far this tournament, his play hasn't been too crazy. Lots of harassment, lots of multi-prong. He's kind of like a mini Jadong, I feel. He just wants to kind of get in there and harass.
I totally agree. He wants to chisel away his opponent and, you know, a lot of times just get ahead with some pretty solid play. We got that Reaper coming up here now. Looks like the SCV may be targeted by these Lings. The Reaper going to come in here and try to save the day. And it looks like this Reaper should be able to take out both these Lings, and there won't really be much of an interruption here on the production of the command center. In fact, I don't think these Lings can really get away at all. So not the most convenient position to be in here.
Ooh, we might actually get that SCV building over there.
He's running!
Nice micro from Jokchi. Manages to keep that going.
Now, see, if this was Nathanius playing in this starting location, an SCV would have popped out of the unfinished command center and killed that last Ling. But we can't all be Nathanius, guys. So,
Jokchi just has to rely on that Reaper micro.
Yeah, he's just going to rely on that Reaper micro. But very well handled there. The Ling's committed to trying to delay that command center. And I mean, yeah, sure, the SCV did stop mining for a minute, but he did have to pull another SCV. So very nicely done.
Jokchi's going to come in for the scout now, wants to check there's no sort of aggression. Does see those drones rallying between the bases. Can see that Impact isn't going for anything too crazy. However, still no third base down for Impact. So Jokchi's got to have a few question marks about exactly what's coming his way. And there we go. That third base is going to go down over on Jokchi's side of the map. We can see Cloak starting up as well. So it looks like some Hellion Banshee play.
Yeah, and I think Hellion Banshee could be quite strong. The third is a reasonable distance from the second base, so it's not that easy to get creep connected there. So if you start to get abusive towards the drones, trying to get the drones to evacuate from the third to the second, or just delaying, you know, any mobility from Queens going up there is going to be a bit of a headache. Cloak is about halfway done. Cloak takes about the time that it takes for two Banshees to make. So definitely this is going to be something Zerg is going to have to respect. And of course, getting the Viking out here along with this is a great move as well. When you take out all these Overlords, The Zerg doesn't know immediately when you're going to be attacking. Whoa.
Just a couple of Zerglings coming in there and forcing so much lost mining time because those Hellions were all the way across this long map. That's beautiful damage. All the lost mining time, especially on double mules, that's a lot of money down the drain for Jakji.
Yeah, you know, not having those mules mining the entire time is definitely a problem. So good job there by Impact. Well, but to what I was saying earlier, these Viking, or the Viking rather, that comes out and hits a bunch of these SCVs. I'm sorry, the Viking that comes out and gets these
Overlords.
These Overlords, thank you. Taking out these Overlords is going to make it a lot harder for Zerg to be completely ready for when this push does come.
Yeah, and that's actually really important, right? Because we see a Nidus Worm coming down for Impact. This is a build he actually used earlier today against Bunny, where he went for a fast Queen, Roach, Nidus all in. It looks like he's going for the same build. Once again, he needs to get that Viking. If he can get rid of that Viking, it's going to make it even easier to have the speed Overlords there providing vision. But, I mean, don't get me wrong. This is completely all in. He needs to overwhelm and kill Jakji with this.
So he's going to get the Queens ready to dive into the Nidus. A lot more Roaches come out. This strategy is all about momentum. If you can get enough units out, doing enough damage, especially with the Terran army trying to move through all these structures, if you can get that damage off, you're going to have your Roaches on top.
Zerglings are going to run into the natural at the same time, Nick, and it's about to move out. There's only a few Marines and Hellions there right now.
And you can see here, the Queens are unloading the transfuses, going down on the Nidus. Enough Roaches to push the SCVs back. 10 casualties so far. And with those links still hitting that second base, there's basically nowhere on this map that is mining.
This is just devastating. A huge surprise maneuver from Impact. There's nothing here to add damage. Those are unupgraded Marines. 1-1 isn't finished. Stim isn't finished. The factory's going to go down just before the double cyclone pops. There's no response to this at all.
It looks like they're not going to be able to deny Stim, but there might not be any Marines left by the time that upgrade finishes. I think this game has been won here. GG! Impact crushing Jakji with his own form of aggression.
Nice decisive play there to kick things off from Impact. And I mean, that's a clean, simple win. It's a great surprise maneuver, and this is really smart in the current meta. People are opening Hellions. They're going double engineering bay behind it, third command centers. The Stim's delayed. There's just not a lot of barracks powering out units. So getting in there with that fast Queen Roach out of the Nidus, I mean, it's just a great all-in maneuver.
I do think the fact that there was a Viking out probably made Jakji even more confident that there wouldn't be some kind of Nidus all in, because he probably thought he had at least driven back all the Overlords.
Yeah.
So he was definitely caught off guard. And, you know, when those Roaches get out like that with the Queens, if you take out a factory or a barracks, there's no way that the Terran units can come out and group up together and fight that, because Terran units are only strong in large groups. They're not strong generally individually. I guess sometimes Cyclones are, but I think everybody knows what I'm saying here.
Yeah, you need to get that big power group together, all of those upgrades kicking in. Of course, guys, we are going to hear from the guys on the desk quickly before we jump into game number two.
All right, thank you very much, gents. Yeah, we had a few series unfold here for bracket number four while your final bracket number three series was going on. So let's take a recount of what was going on. Todd, you had Minimath versus Thalanadros, but he was going under a different name in that game.
Yeah, it was on Berger Vestige, GVZ, and Minimath just took an earlier third and never really let go of his lead. I was actually thinking, Thalandra's not doing too bad. Next thing you know, after minutes of having an earlier third base, Minimath has like 40 more supply, goes across the map and kills him. So pretty straightforward. They just started game number two on New Curve Precinct.
And Artosis, you had Drogo versus Q-Ben, I believe?
Yes, but after that, he's going to be Q-Q-Ben because he proxied an Oracle in like a pretty far away spot,
right.
But Petit Drogo's checked absolutely everything, found it, killed the pylon. I mean, it was kind of brutal, and he just kept pressuring, kept shading in, and eventually picked off everything.
Right. And finally, we did have Indy versus Mana going on. Roddy, I think you have some footage for us.
Yeah, just a tiny bit of footage of game number two. I missed the first game. We weren't ready for it yet. But it's kind of funny, because if this game would have been on the mainstream, I would have hyped it up. I would have been like, guys, this is actually really cool, because Indy is like a pretty fun Protoss player to watch. He's a streamer as well. Well, let's just go ahead and jump into the laptop. I know it's pause right now, but I just want to show you guys one thing. Barely anything happened in this game, right? They're doing the same thing. I mean, six probes died. Well, if you wonder what's the difference between a guy that's like rank 60 GM and a game like Mana, this is the very first attack in the game. Drops a couple force fields. Indy went for Blink, Mana just went for Resonating Glaives. and that's it, James. Like, the game just ends here. Mana just walked across the map with an army after killing a couple of workers, and that's it. Mana advances.
So that was the difference?
Yep.
To rank 60 and top 10. You made force fields and killed him.
No, but it's ridiculous, right? Like, it's just like, it's the, almost an even game. A couple of workers, it's like, well, herpy derp, walk across the map, and it's over.
All right, well, thank you very much, gents. We're going to head back on over to the commentary desk for game number two here between Jack G and Impact to see who moves on to the group stage.
All right, Impact right now with a 1-0 lead against Jack G. I don't think we're going to see that same strat from Zerg, but sometimes, just because it's almost a bad idea, it'll work anyways, you know?
Yeah.
If they get a little bit repetitious. I don't think we're going to have it, but he might try to do some kind of super mind game stuff and throw his opponent off. Although, I'm expecting a more normal game.
Yeah, I definitely would expect. Well, and even if he goes for some type of hyper aggression, probably not the same Roach Queen Nidus move.
Right.
I do like that, though, to see this. You know, the meta shifts in StarCraft, and it's very easy to just go along with what's normal in the current meta and not identify the weaknesses. But you can see Impact there has been thinking for himself and finding ways to take advantage of it.
In the upper left. In the red, he needs to win this game and the next. He is Jack G!
Standing between him and that spot, and himself only one game away from qualifying for the group stage, our Zerg player, it is Impact. Impact is being.
That's interesting.
Yeah, that's a Gaston pool. However, Impact is a big fan of doing this as more of a standard opening. So
yeah.
I don't think we'll necessarily see him go too crazy off that. Of course, he'll be able to get faster queens, faster Zergling speed to deal with any sort of Reaper aggression. As well as we saw in that last game, he loves to sneak a few Zerglings around the edge of the map and try to slow down the command center of Terran.
So we've seen this a lot. Not this strat, not the strategy I'm about to talk about, but I'm curious about this because in the last 30 days, ZVT, we've had a lot of these Ravager rushes. Before we get into this game, I'm curious, what are your thoughts on that? These 3 to 4 Ravagers that come up there, they start to hit the depots. Sometimes things spiral out of control, but a lot of times we see that not work. What is your take as a Zerg expert on that approach? Is it cheesy? Is it actually pretty safe?
I think it really comes down to rush distance a lot of the time, as well as Terran players, whether or not they want to SCV scout. Here on Paladino Terminal, this is the shortest rush distance in the current map pool. So if there is one map where that sort of rush can be very powerful, this is it. Of course, a lot of Terran players not SCV scouting. This game, Jack G, not SCV scouting, but Impact didn't choose to go for it this time around. Instead, he's just going to sneak some Zergans around the south, and ooh, it looks like he might go for maybe his 28 drone Roachling attack. Still quite all in, but not as fast as those early Ravager rushes.
Yeah, it's a different style, guys. So just because we're seeing the Roach Warren here doesn't necessarily mean it's going to be like what we've seen in a lot of the GSLs lately, as well as this IEM here. Now, what's funny about these two strategies they're both doing, usually this is meant to try to pry in and punish a player who's playing a standard game. But in this case, neither player is actually playing standards. So moments like this require a lot of intuition on both sides. Now, the thing about Reapers really is they're not exactly great against Roaches. You know, you can run away from them, but you know, if you have to get head-to-head in a fight, they just explode.
They can kind of delay attacks forever, I think, is their big power. They're really good at kind of holding off an all-in, but actually doing damage to the Roaches is a completely different story. So far, they've done a bit of harassment, they've weakened a queen, but now spotting those early Roaches, Jack G is going to have to play a little bit more conservative. We can already see Marine production starting up, Factory on the way. So that transition is starting, and Jack G really appreciating just how dangerous this situation is, doesn't even have a command center down, and he's already just focusing on getting up that next stage of his arm.
But I think this was a really good switch into Marines because I mean, Reapers are really great early on, but they don't give you many opportunities the further the game goes along. And if you're going to go for mass Reapers, you're not making Marines. Marines allow you to get a lot more stability in the mid game. So this is a good switch out of this. He's going to need some solid defense because Marines, even though they're not great against Roaches really either, they're better than Reapers if they actually have to fight head to head, especially with the company of Bunkers. We've got some Ravagers coming up here. You were highlighting this earlier, Pig, and I couldn't agree more. The real strength of Reapers is they can delay rushes like this. And it's actually pretty easy with the Reaper grenades to kind of position it in front of the Ravagers. Ravagers are not that fast. And just the way the physics of the game works, you can almost always basically get the grenade to chuck him back a little bit.
Exactly. Makes it very difficult to force your way in there. So I actually like the way Impact's playing. He's just got the four Ravager squad. I think that's enough to one-shot a Reaper, or at least kill Reapers very quickly.
Yeah, I'm not sure how many Ravager shots kill a Reaper, actually.
I really should know that with how many games I play. Yep, there we go. It is the right number.
Yeah.
So one-shotting those Reapers, and now he can shoo this away. And behind this, he's just been droning up really well. And since Jakji, I mean, he is transitioning himself, but his command center's still in the main base. He doesn't have an orbital up yet. So I actually think this situation favors Impact quite well. He's already got a lair on the way as well.
And kudos to Impact for reacting properly. He did not just stick with exactly what he started out doing. The moment he identified the Reapers are going to be a factor here, he shifted gears pretty well. Stim is about halfway done. Medivacs are on the way. When you have Stim and Medivacs, that's where the Terran does have the option of becoming abusive on the map, whereas the Zerg has to basically deflect and defend as much as possible. But you got to be careful, because Impact is one of these guys who will always counter you if he can.
Yeah, absolutely. And this is one of these games where it's not...
He's so good. That was sick.
One kill, one hit.
Get
under
it.
That's an Impact thing. And going to delay the commitment by a few seconds.
And this is a Terran on one base. And by the way, the Ravager's out. You're not exactly comfortable leaving your base. So he still has the Ravagers far back enough, unbeknownst to the Zerg, that I think he'll be able to reclaim this pretty easily. But, you know, that little delay that we're seeing right here, this is so sick. This is, you know, StarCraft's not always won with a brilliant strategy or a big attack. Sometimes it's death by a thousand cuts, and that could very well be one of them.
Right now, though, there is a double medivac drop coming across for Jakji. The timings are so strange in this game, I'm not sure if Impact was prepared for this. He does seem to have quite a few Roaches and Ravagers here. He can't let those Ravagers get focused down, though. Nice zoning out with those corrosive vials. He's going to have to protect the third base. And Jakji, he'd love to find a bit of direct damage here, but it's not like he needs to kill Impact with this move.
Now, he may have fished Impact out far enough. Those Ravagers were not on creep, nor were some of those Roaches. So coming back up here into the main, you know what? Impact's defense is just so good. Those four Roaches are going to one-shot anything that comes out of that medevac right away, and that's going to give him enough time to get those Ravagers up there. So Jakji has rotated back around. Again, this is a very late second base.
This is so hard for the players right now. How do you judge? Do I go just full economy from here? Do I transition?
Yeah.
Do I commit to a two-base push? Both players, they've got so little information about what their opponent's going to be doing in the follow-up. It's very hard to make a call on exactly what direction they want to go from here.
And you know what's funny about it is that, again, guys, these builds were both that they were doing were intended to punish a player or exploit a very standard game. But because they're both doing these kind of weird builds, a lot more instinct is at play in this series. As Pig was saying, it is a little bit tricky. Okay, like, yeah, do you go full macro? Do you try to, like, gear up and do some kind of a timing attack? It's becoming a pretty tight game.
Tunneling Claws is on the way for Impact. That's going to be cute. Potentially could be very nice. Of course, Jakji, with such a delayed income, isn't going to be able to afford to just have blind turrets all over the place. He's still zoning about with this drop. Hasn't really found any direct damage, but he's making sure that Impact is massing out those Roaches. And each time he sees the size of Impact's army, it reassures him, because it tells him that Impact hasn't just built 30 drones and has some sort of monstrous economy back at home.
So Impact right now with the Roach Ravager has a lot of muscle on the map here. Now, you got to be careful, because Roach Ravager, Roaches eat up a lot of supply. So sometimes this isn't like the most ideal thing to keep going with all the way into the late game, but it's definitely something Terran has to respect. Terran can't really fight this head-to-head on the ground. They have to try to find a weaker area. Oh, okay, good dodge there.
Yeah, there is a bit more upgrades on the way for Impact, but right now his army is very strong, so you're just spot on Tasteless. Jakji just needs to lock the door and just defend. And there's no way Roach Ravager can break this in a defensive position, but if he catches the Terran in the middle of the map, in the wide open ground, that's where those Roaches and Ravagers can just overwhelm the Terran army. Of course, the dynamic changes as we get closer to max supply, though. As the upgrades kick in, as you get like a maxed out biotank army, suddenly Roach Ravager becomes really bad.
Yeah, exactly. This allows you to have a lot more, you can threaten a lot more in the middle of the map with the Roach Ravager army, but yeah, it just doesn't lead you to the right spots in the endgame. You eventually have to tech out of this. But I gotta say, I think Jakji's been very conservative with these medevacs. He's definitely keeping Zerg pretty uncomfortable from the idea of moving around the map too much. And he's keeping him busy.
Nice couple of snipes on these overlords in the corner.
Yeah.
It's good to... Ooh, actually, a bit of a Doom Drop going to go into the main
base
here.
But it looks like he might already be ready.
Yeah, Impact is on top of everything right now. Jakji, I don't know if this is the right call to keep on going through here. He's going to try to hunt down the drop on the north side as well, but JackG is going to shut down those Ravages. Meanwhile, getting a few drone kills on the natural. The scan! Oh my god, drone massacre, Tasteless!
That was beautiful, taking out any drones that were remaining over there. The Roaches are coming in. There are still a few medevacs and Marines. Eventually, he will have to pull out, and he does just that. But with 22 drones massacred, and that number isn't getting any lower.
Oh man, Impact had all the numbers he needed to defend this, but he just wasn't in the right position. Great maneuvers from JackG, just pulling him around in circles. 38 drones have gone down. JackG.
Jesus, man, it's almost 45 drones. This is some tactical brilliance here. As you were saying, Pig, he had the tools necessary to stop this from happening, but he wasn't in the right position. Eventually, JackG just pulled Impact apart.
So many of those Roaches just still burrowed out in the middle of the map, just doing nothing this entire time. Impact, oh, this was a disastrous turn of events here in the mid-game, but yeah, hats off to JackG. He fished for this. I was saying, I don't know if it's the right idea to keep going in when it looks like the Roaches and Ravages are so prepared, but he found that opening on the natural. Impact was just slightly too slow to respond, and now it's just, it's like whack-a-mole Terran drops just flying between bases up and down. There's just not enough Zerg units to keep up with them anymore.
Yeah.
Income is so much higher for Terran.
By the way, what we saw JackG do here is one of the harder things for Terran to do at this phase of the game. To try to pull apart a Zerg that was that high in supply and do this kind of damage, that is crazy. And that's going to be it. GG! We are going into game number three as this series is tied up 1-1.
This is one of these weird series where both players are throwing curveballs at each other. They're both trying to just bring out these very unorthodox styles and plays. And I think, that's almost a standard game for Paladino Terminal. Both players try to go super aggressive on this tiny rush map. You get in this really weird position, but JackG, he looks almost a little bit tense there. Even though, I'd be pretty happy if I just did that.
Yeah, well, that's got to feel really good, taking out a Zerg like that back there, especially if you consider the way that Impact won in game number one was that surprise Nidus rush. And that's one of those moments where it's like, you're not like slowly killing him and then taking him out and then you win. With a Nidus rush, you're just like, I got all this stuff in your base and now you can't do anything.
Yeah, it's actually the worst way to lose. You're just like, oh, you kind of you pull your SCVs enough. And you pull them away and then you go back, oh, I just don't have enough stuff. Like, it's just over. It's that one punch that knocks you out. So it does feel good for him to get that one back over, especially because, we're saying the whole time it's a dicey position, right? Like, it's a little bit scary, that big Roach army marauding around the map. But yeah, JackG just went out there, no fear, found the opening and got in there and equalizes the series.
So based on the way that it takes to win game one versus game two, I would say JackG seems to be in better form. But, you know, Impact may attempt to play around this with another crazy strat that might knock JackG off his feet. Anyways, let's go ahead and go to the analysis desk and see how these other games are going. And what everybody's thoughts are as we go into game number three.
I think we might actually be staying with us, I think. So we're just going to stay with us because the players are about to dive into game in just a moment. So we'll just hang on here for just a minute and we will be going into that game number three momentarily, Tasteless.
I can't wait.
Of course, it is going to be more TVZ action. And this is interesting. I'm sure there's some guys watching at home and saying, where's the Mutiling Bane versus like Bio Widowmine? Where's the big mid macro games EVT? You gotta remember both of these guys have flown all the way from Korea, just like yourself. And they're probably feeling a bit of the jet lag around now. And not only that, it's a high pressure game. It's not necessarily something where you just want to go in and say, oh, I'm just gonna play dead standard. We've seen both of them have these crazy aggressive builds. In game three, when everything's on the line, are they gonna play standard? Are they gonna play a bit more conservative?
You know, jet lag is a big factor. You know, it's hard to do anything when you're jet-lagged, but playing StarCraft, that's a tall order. Also, you know, I think they're trying to use some of these unorthodox styles. We've had, especially in Game 2 back there, they both went for builds that were attempting to, you know, dismantle a normal game, and then they're stuck in this really weird game where it's not clear. It's probably not what they practiced for a lot at home. But it's going to be fun. I think JackG might be able to take this in Game 3 unless Impact has an ace up his sleeve.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised to see Impact continue to play aggressively here in game number three. Of course, we are going to be going into Belshir Vestige, a blast from the past here. And our Terran player spawning in the bottom right-hand side. It is JackG.
And And his opponent here in the upper left, our blue Zerg, he is Impact.
This is an interesting map. It is a map far from the past where there aren't that many bases. There's only 5 bases on each side of the map. And once you get up to those 4th and 5th bases, you're spitting distance from each other. So once you do get into that mid game, it's a little bit hard for Zerg to defend in the mid game. But then once Ultralisks and Infestors and all these units get out, it's also very hard for Terran to hang on to that 4th base if the Zerg's counterattacking all over the place.
And I guess the real question we got to ask ourselves is, will the Zerg embrace that or play around it? It depends on how comfortable people are against certain players in the late game versus the mid game. And you know, that is a real problem, right? If Zerg have to weather the storm before getting the strength and the assets of the map, they have to let Terran have the advantage for a little bit. That sometimes can be viewed as undesirable. On the other hand, you get people that just really have solid mid game and they just want the game to progress as long as it can, because they know they're probably in the long run gonna have more stamina and stay ahead.
Very curious to see how Jack-G chooses to play against Impact. Impact has shown he's an absolute nightmare to deal with when it comes to Zergling run-bys. Not to mention, of course, that Nidus play we saw in Game 1. And I was actually about to say, I wonder if he's going to open up 2-1-1, because Impact seems to be so good at taking advantage of those Hellion builds. Yeah, Hellions get to his natural, and bam, there's a few Zerglings back in your base tearing up your SCVs. But this is going to be a much meatier opening for Jack-G. A little bit old school, not as popular these days, just going for a very fast double Marine Medivac Stim drop.
Yeah, and this is very traditional TVZ that we've seen plenty of before, where you just have these two medevacs, and obviously one of the things you gotta be careful about is you do not lose those medevacs, you do not lose with any pressure that you have on the map. But I think it's smart, as you were saying, yeah, I mean, the Hellions don't seem to be very strong against Impact. You know, a lot of other Zerg players, they have to fight the Hellions and struggle with it. Impact, again, he kind of plays around that. He's very good with those counterattacks. So Jock-G just eliminating that from his strategy in the hopes that he can get ahead even in that sense.
Overlord speed is going to be on the way for Impact, so once again, just really favoring to see absolutely everything that Jack-G can send his way. That is going to put a bit of a dent in Impact's income, but will give him 100% vision and all the information he needs to react and defend. The way this plays out for Jack-G, on the other hand, Nick, I like what you said about how he can't really lose the medevacs at all. You can't really give up any of the pressure, because you really are balancing everything on a knife's edge with this. It's all about keep the Zerg uncomfortable for as long as possible, keep pushing back creep without actually giving away any of your units for free.
And, you know, it may be a situation where Impact discovers that Jock-G is very good at doing that, or the reverse, where, you know, Impact completely shuts us down, just like he would the Hellions. He knows how to handle it. But this is overall a very good bread and butter TVZ build. You know, the strengths of it are very apparent. You're able to abuse the mobility of the medevacs, and the fact that you can basically pick your fight with the Zerg and up until the moment where you decide that it's not going to benefit you, and then get up and leave.
Yeah.
And I guess the most important tiny thing to take notice of when you're watching a strat like this is the vitality of the medevacs, because if they get too low, things can fall apart.
That was really nice by Jack-G.
Yeah.
Just hit that Reaper in the main base for like a full minute. Impact just kind of ignored it, left it be, and it came back in and it saw the Roach Warren going down. And that's such an important thing for Jack-G to see. Now he knows he's up against Roach Ravager, which means Impact, he's going to have a very strong frontal army, but not the same maneuverability. And that exact same multi-prong sort of out-positioning drop play that won in the last game could be very successful here.
All right, well, we've got solid 16 Marines coming out here. The two medevacs are about to come in and pair well with that group of Marines on the map here. And we'll have to see now how the execution is for both parties.
Ooh, cute adjustment by Impact. On the right-hand side, a Dropper Lord has just loaded up with 8 Zerglings. Going to make use of that early Zergling, early Overlord speed. And he's going to try and hit with those Zerglings in the main base just as the double drop is hitting in order to distract Jack-G and just pull his APM away from the engagement. But a very nice Marine positioning there should spot that.
Okay, well, now it's going to be very clear to Impact with where the Marines are. So the drop is going to come in here. They'll be able to take out those that Marine.
Oh, that's not a lot of roaches.
Yeah, this is actually not enough. And in fact, the Ravager is morphing right over here. The Queen does go down.
Oh,
and I believe the second one will be killed as well. And this could actually spiral out of control as the Ravager should be gunned down there as well. Impact right now not even microing those links, so not able to use this possible position to his advantage.
This is massive. Impact was just caught slightly unprepared. And this is what can happen if you haven't played against this build in a while. You're just a few seconds too late with those roaches, and suddenly massive damage is happening.
Impact, so Impact is getting bopped right now. This was actually not supposed to be like such a dramatic move. But if you're not ready, the bopping can occur.
Yeah, it's like, hey, this is meant to clear some creep and make the Zerg build fighting
stuff.
Like,
wait a minute, you
just
stem?
Killed every single queen, roach, and ravager. Okay, sure. Yeah, I'll take that. Why not?
Think about the insane amount of value that Jakji got there. Because even though Impact knew that he might be able to use that drop Overlord positionally to his advantage, he didn't have the right defensive setup, and it's happening again right here, right now. Impact is falling apart. Drones getting gunned down.
Just the way these Marines work, when you have enough of them, because they deal such high damage, but they're very fragile, you're not losing units. Your damage gets out of control. The third hatchery is going to fall. Oh, that's going to be pretty much game over. Like, Jakji is just walking over Impact right now.
This is a serious arrow to the knee of Impact in this game. I don't know.
He's going to have to go and apply for a job guarding a gate somewhere or something.
Yeah, this is... This is so bad for Zerg. I mean, normally Zergs, this was like older StarCraft, we'd be like, oh, there you go, the Zerg lost a third base, this is good for the Terran. Zergs don't normally lose the third base, especially not to just a drop. This is like a game you win on the ladder, and you're like, I'm going to be at my rank eventually, but clearly if I'm beating people like this, I am not placed correctly. So I think from here, there's a lot of different things that Jakji can exploit, but I think most of all, you just come in there and keep beating up the Zerg. Don't miss any depots, keep making stuff, and stay on top of the Zerg, and you'll probably win this in the next few minutes.
Yeah, he's got the third base heading down to land. He's got double upgrades heading towards 2-2. There's very little creep spread out for Impact. Can Impact even defend this next poke at the third base? I don't think he can. He's only got a few roaches here.
The Marines are now coming in. There are a lot of roaches. The Queen's trying to target these medevacs.
Oh my gosh, traitor mine there. Just, I believe that hit the Terran units more than the Zerg. Must have been some good micro from Impact to pull a roach forward and then lure that shot in.
And you know what, this is pretty good here as well. The fact that he actually got the creep down there where that command center is. He'll have to get some Marines down there to try to drive that out as well. But super annoying play there by Impact. Again, if Jakji overextends a little bit too much, that can be one very simple way this game would balance out.
And he's got Burrow finishing up, so maybe if he can sneak in some Tunneling Claw Roaches, that could be really good. It would have been really funny if he actually Burrowed a Zergling underneath the third base as well as dropping creep there. But Jakji is going to get that third base down now. And when his 2-2 finishes, oh my gosh, as Zerg, how do you defend that? Impact's only chance is to get Tunneling Claw Roaches into the mineral lines of Jakji and like just buy 5 minutes of time to catch up and upgrade.
Yeah, you're totally right, Pig. At 2-2, the Terran army is so robust. You got to factor in, it's not just how quickly can you kill that Terran, but Marines do so much damage so fast that it could spiral out of control for the Zerg. We do have some Burrowed Roaches now moving through this area, hoping to maybe try to deter Jakji from moving out on the map, but I think Jakji's already gone too far. He's going to be unloading not just over here, but in the main base of Impact.
Triple drop going in there, and Jakji catches the Tunneling Claw Roach counterattack at the same time. Jakji is on top of everything this game. No surprise is going to be catching him out. Just going to fight these roaches head on, focus firing them down there with those Marines. And that is some beautiful play from Jakji. The drop coming back in on the third base at the same time. Drones starting to fall. Impact is on the ropes right now, and Jakji is just pummeling him. He is not giving him any ground.
Yeah, this is just not stopping. Jakji is just shredding apart the expansions here for Impact. So many drones killed throughout this game, and that is not slowing down anytime soon.
Yeah, now that he's found his way in there and he's put Impact on the back foot, Jakji is able to bounce in and out with these drops. There's zero pressure on his side of the map, and that just allows Jakji to put all of his APM into that multi-prong, into that harassment. Now he says, okay, cool, let's go back, let's macro a little bit, and I'm sure in the next moments, yeah, we're going to see a huge army moving across the map. It looks like he's very focused on doom dropping for the moment.
Yeah, the fact that he's comboing these drops so hard, you know, it's almost making Impact look kind of crazy for even sending any roaches out on the map here. Most of the medevacs are also surviving this, so they can always go back and shuttle in even more units. The targeting from Jakji on Impact's roaches has been very good, but he has to make sure that he's careful to try to fight these units in small numbers and not just everything at once. Because really, if you have all your Roaches and Ravagers in the right position, Terran can't do anything. The problem is that the Medivacs are so much more mobile than Roach Ravager ever could be.
And he's worked himself up into a very nice advantage right now. It looks like 2-2 is about to finish for Impact. He's going to equalize those upgrades at least for a while. But Jack G closing in on Max. He has a huge income. He has a huge army. And funnily enough, he doesn't seem to want to do the frontal push just yet. I do feel like a siege tank push on the front, abusing the cliffs and the ledges on Belshire would be unstoppable. But Jack G's done such a good job with the drop so far. Why stop now?
Medivacs are headed northbound here. Again, the idea of Xur taking a fourth base is a hard one to imagine with the kind of pressure that Terran has, not to mention, as Pig was talking about earlier on this map, the fourth base is very pushable for Terran. So the fact that Jakji has been beating up Impact pretty hard throughout this game that's already gone past 10 minutes, there's not really been a moment where Impact's had a lead.
Yeah.
We're about to get into a very dangerous time period in this game on this map, and I don't know if Impact has the stamina or the muscle within his Zerg army to actually combat what Jakji can throw at him.
I'm down there on the map. There's a big blue bulb. Oh wow!
Oh, Tunneling
Claws catch the siege tanks. Very nice triple siege tank snipe, but he's got to get out of there. That's a lot of bio close on his tail. Those Roaches need to run. They need to get on out of there. But what a great trade. A very good start to the potential turnaround. A few Roaches do try to Tunneling Claw their way past. They do get scanned on down. Nice interception there from Jack G.
And I think the play there from Impact was good up until the Roaches weren't able to get back out. That means the army is going to be even smaller here for Impact if Jack G does decide that it's time to actually push in.
Jack G stimming down here into the third base once more. No units in position. A few more drones are going to fall. And oh, here we go. The siege tank push is coming in. A huge bio tank force on that left-hand side. Going to begin to work its way forwards. There's just not enough Roach Ravager. He's not even fighting with the siege tanks, and he's still overwhelming the Zerg.
Yeah, and with the Marauders in the back there, the Marines and Marauders together, especially with the tanks comboed in here, are so strong. Jakji pretty much always has the first shot and can initiate the fight with ease. And in fact, even with a decent concave versus the convex, Jakji is doing too much damage here to Impact.
The healing from those medevacs is just out of control right now. As soon as these units stim, they're just getting healed up. Nice fungal biles are landing. A lot of medevacs actually do start to fall. Impact taking the best fight he could possibly hope for, but I don't think it's going to be enough to take.
Yeah, out of nowhere, an entire other army came up to replace those units that were picked off. Very nicely done. Don't forget, there's still been a drop at the upper right side of the map. So Jakji just too fast for Impact to keep up, and that will make him our winner in this series with a 2-1 victory.
He's going to be going through to the group stage into the top 24, securing himself a minimum of $1,000 extra in this tournament.
Money.
As well as his chance to go even further. Jakji, really a player who's just been going from a regular run-of-the-mill Korean pro to someone who's actually really working his way closer and closer to that upper echelon.
Jakji reminding everybody that at points in time in StarCraft II history, this was possibly the best Terran in the world, man. I mean, this guy was really scary, and you could see why. And I think Impact, he put up a good fight, but he got too far behind there. I think a lesser Zerg player would have died much faster, so that really does show you what a tenacious fighter Impact is. But yeah, I mean, Jakji starts to get momentum. It's really hard to recover.
He just kind of ran away with those games, and I just still can't believe that moment on Paladino where Impact was up a game. He was looking so confident.
Yeah.
He had that big, scary Roach Ravager force, and then it was just like, hey, there's medevacs in three locations at once, and your entire economy is just gone. Magic trick.
We're going to go to a short break. When we come back, more StarCraft II action here at the Intel Extreme Masters.